The truth is that when my mentor suggested this talk to me, at first I said, I've been given a talk that's going to be complicated to handle. But then I also realized that it's a problem I'm going to encounter practically every day. And it's something that causes me a lot of doubts when I'm in consultation. This doesn't just raise doubts for me. I've talked many times with my mentor from La Fe about it. What is this seronegative rheumatoid arthritis hiding? I'm going to try to shed some light on this. I've done a bit of a review. I'm going to go a bit in depth with this topic, but I think we're doing fine on time, so let's talk about it. The first thing I asked myself was, is seronegative rheumatoid arthritis really typical rheumatoid arthritis? And we're going to talk a little about this. You know, I love pathophysiology. Dr. Salmantin explained it very well at the beginning. At the beginning, patients with seronegative rheumatoid arthritis, we see a very homogeneous clinical presentation. We know quite reliably that there are some genetic risk factors that are very well defined. We have modifiable non-genetic risk factors that are closely related to the etiopathogenic role of rheumatoid arthritis, such as, for example, smoking. Smoking leads to excessive citrullination of proteins, which creates these proteins that are antigenic, and antibodies are formed against them. And that's why we have the rheumatoid factor and the AKPAs in the blood. This autoimmune role of rheumatoid arthritis is related to these antibodies. We can see that seropositive patients are much more aggressive and will affect the joints much more severely. Greater erosion, greater joint deformity. In contrast, these patients with seronegative rheumatoid arthritis, we have a much more heterogeneous clinical presentation and a much more heterogeneous genetic background that is not as closely related to seronegative rheumatoid arthritis. We see joint involvement that is different, and we'll notice a predominance in this clinical picture. Or rather, these environmental risk factors will play a much more significant role than in patients with seropositive rheumatoid arthritis. As Dr. San Martin explained very well, if we indeed focus on a patient with chronic polyarthritis, we could certainly diagnose them with rheumatoid arthritis. We might have patients with many affected joints, elevated acute phase reactants, and a chronicity of more than 6 weeks. We could practically include them as they would meet the criteria with a score greater than 6. And we could diagnose a patient with rheumatoid arthritis without the need for them to have positive rheumatoid factor or AKPAs. I wanted to share this study with you, which is a recent study from September 2024. It's very interesting because it includes a group of nearly 500 patients with rheumatoid arthritis. Thank you. Initially, they were diagnosed as seronegative and were followed up for 10 years. Almost 90% of the patients had a change in diagnosis after 10 years. We could observe the little arrows. What they indicate is that the majority of patients would meet the criteria for the spondyloarthritis family: axial spondyloarthritis, peripheral spondyloarthritis, psoriatic arthritis. But then we would also see patients with diseases from the spectrum, from polymyalgia rheumatica to giant cell arteritis, patients with microcrystalline arthritis, patients with other diseases such as, for example, vasculitis like PAN, which can cause polyarthralgias that may be related. Only about 10-12% of patients retain the diagnosis of undifferentiated arthritis or seronegative rheumatoid arthritis. Of these, and in the end, only 2.9 patients, only 13 patients, could be considered seropositive. Thank you. Or with typical erosions of rheumatoid arthritis. Just realize, only 2 patients became positive for rheumatoid factor, and another 2 patients became positive for ACP over this 10-year follow-up. The rest had erosions that we would traditionally associate with rheumatoid arthritis, but there were a number of patients in whom we observed involvement, erosions, in large joints. And this is what we were giving the patients. Thank you. These were patients with polyarticular juvenile idiopathic arthritis, that had progressed over the year, had not been diagnosed, and were now presenting with these erosions and had been diagnosed as such. When we talk about seronegative rheumatoid arthritis, what are we referring to? Well, up to 20-30% of patients with rheumatoid arthritis may be classified as having seronegative rheumatoid arthritis. And what we're seeing is an increase in the incidence of this condition. And what could be causing this? It could be due to environmental and demographic factors. For example, we have patients. Our patients are part of an aging population. And when we diagnose patients with arthritis, rheumatoid arthritis in the elderly Many times it turns out to be seronegative rheumatoid arthritis. And then, for example, fortunately, we are seeing a decrease in smoking. Smoking, which is related to anti-sitarine antibodies and which are more closely related to senile rheumatoid arthritis, seropositive. I wanted to share with you this project I'm working on with my colleagues from the EFI. It's my doctoral thesis, supervised by Dr. Roman, in which I set out to explore this topic. This group of 30% of patients with seronegative rheumatoid arthritis could actually be seropositive for some other antibody. And here we studied what is known as carbamylation, which is another form of epigenetic modification similar to citrullination, but in this case it has been observed that it is not as closely linked to tobacco use. In this study, what we did was examine patients with rheumatoid arthritis. We evaluated anti-carbamylated antibodies in patients and healthy controls. And what we found here is that in this group, among the seronegative patients, up to 13% could be reclassified as seropositive rheumatoid arthritis. Not only that, but we have observed that these new antibodies, new or not so new, that are already associated, not only with the number of painful joints is associated with higher disease activity as measured by DAS28. And also with a greater number of articular manifestations, including rheumatoid nodules and interstitial lung disease. But the first distinction we need to make in patients with rheumatoid arthritis is genetic. Have we seen this? Dr. Leal also asked this yesterday. And we are very clear that patients with seronegative rheumatoid arthritis are all associated with the HLA-DRB104 system, which is primarily linked to this. Not only that, but we also have other genetic alterations related to the system. Non-HLA, mainly the JAK-STAT pathway, which we do see in patients with seropositive rheumatoid arthritis and not so much in patients with seronegative rheumatoid arthritis. These alterations in the HLA system are closely related to the activation of the adaptive immune system. This production of autoantibodies, this stimulation of T lymphocytes and B lymphocytes, which will produce the antibodies related to this. On the other hand, we have patients with seronegative rheumatoid arthritis in whom these same genetic relationships have been tested and not observed. The HLA system is not as closely related to seronegative rheumatoid arthritis. In fact, what we observe are these minor genetic alterations, mainly in the non-HLA system and primarily in the innate immune system. This has been correlated with alterations in the synovial joint. When we conducted a study of these cells, what we observed in patients with rheumatoid arthritis was exactly what we all expected to see. We have patients with CD4 positive T cells with CD3, CD31, CD68, which are mainly associated with adaptive immunity. On the other hand, we have patients with seronegative rheumatoid arthritis, and in this study, what is shown is that we don't see as much these cells of the adaptive immune system, but rather we see a higher prevalence of cells that are associated with the innate immune system. These synovial monocytes, antigen-presenting cells, dendritic cells, macrophages, plasma cells, but it doesn't stop there. Studies have been conducted comparing patients with psoriatic arthritis, which often raises diagnostic questions alongside seronegative rheumatoid arthritis, with patients who have seronegative rheumatoid arthritis. And it has been observed that there is a higher number of plasma cells in patients with rheumatoid arthritis compared to mast cells, which are significantly more elevated in patients with psoriatic arthritis. Another point is that in patients with seronegative rheumatoid arthritis, there is a lower number of PD-1 inhibitors. And you might ask me, Pablo, why are you bringing this up in our talk? Because we are increasingly seeing in patients we treat with checkpoint inhibitors with anti-PD-1 that what we are getting is polyarthritis, chronic, similar to seronegative rheumatoid arthritis. So we can see that this signaling mechanism between T cells and B cells may be closely related to the involvement and to the clinical presentation of seronegative arthritis. Not only that, I've been reviewing. I'm not sure if you're all familiar with dupilumab, which is a drug used for patients with conditions like asthma. This drug, what it does is inhibit interleukin-4 and interleukin-13. Asthma or manifestations like this condition are associated with Th2 cells. What this drug does is block the seroconversion to Th2 cells, leading to a dysregulation of the Th2 response. And it activates the Th1-Th17 system, with an increased production of interleukin-17 and interleukin-23. And these patients who are treated with this drug as a side effect eventually undergo seroconversion and develop manifestations of psoriatic arthritis, spondyloarthritis, and psoriasis, which may be closely related to this. And on the other hand, the role of interleukin-1 has been observed in the pathophysiology of patients with seronegative rheumatoid arthritis. And this is very important because interleukin-1 does not go through the JAK-STAT signaling pathway. And this may explain why we have many patients with seronegative rheumatoid arthritis who do not respond well to treatment with JAK inhibitors. Not only that, yesterday our colleagues from Alicante already mentioned it, we often use interleukin-1 antagonists for the treatment of gout. And the fact is that there are many patients with seronegative rheumatoid arthritis who, upon examination, can be shown to have the presence of uric acid crystals or pyrophosphate crystals. We can associate all of this with the clinical presentation, and when we examine the patients, we can observe that those with seronegative rheumatoid arthritis have a higher Sarvander High Index, meaning more erosion and greater disease activity. Not only that, we also see that it affects the joints, meaning we have different patterns of joint involvement. Patients with rheumatoid arthritis show more involvement of the metacarpophalangeal joints, with a higher frequency or greater number of cases of synovitis. In contrast, in patients with seronegative rheumatoid arthritis, we would more often see tenosynovitis or more extrasynovial involvement, such as tendinitis of the finger extensors or flexors. This often also makes us hesitate when we're trying to differentiate between seronegative rheumatoid arthritis and psoriatic arthritis. It can be very helpful for us. You can already see where I'm going with all of this. Everything is somewhat intertwined with spondyloarthritis. The same thing happens with treatment response. Both can be treated with methotrexate. Both show a good initial response to methotrexate, but it's true that this response tends to be more sustained over time and better in patients with seropositive rheumatoid arthritis. The same goes for anti-TNF drugs. They are appropriately indicated for both diseases. And the response is good, but when there is a failure with anti-TNF treatment, the situation is no longer the same between the two conditions. We could see that patients with seropositive rheumatoid arthritis, whom we treat with methotrexate to prevent the formation of these antibodies, respond much more effectively to anti-TNF treatment. And usually, failure to a second anti-TNF may be mediated by these antibodies. In contrast, seronegative rheumatoid arthritis is not as mediated by the adaptive immune system, but rather more by the innate immune system. So in that case, it might be worth considering switching to anti-TNF. The same applies to drugs that target the adaptive immune system, such as those against CD20 and the anti-CD86 system, like abatacept. I'll say it again. Rheumatoid arthritis is mediated by the adaptive immune system. We have antibodies, we have the production of this type of cells. When we use these drugs, they work very well in this type of patient, but the innate immune system is not going to respond as well to them. When they published this study, which was in early 2023, there wasn't as much experience with JAK inhibitors yet. They included as much experience with JAKs as they had, which is why they say that the response to JAK inhibitors in rheumatoid and seronegative arthritis is uncertain. It's true that they didn't study all the JAK inhibitor drugs, which we later see in daily clinical practice that some of them do work better, or that some are indicated, for example, for axial or peripheral spondyloarthritis, which can be very useful for covering both treatments. In conclusion, I've brought this as a take-home message, where we see that there are differences in the etiopathogenesis of rheumatoid and seronegative arthritis, such as alterations in the microbiome, exposure to silica, or aging. In comparison to those patients who have a stronger association, smoking, this citrullination process that may be related to the disease. But we have these genetic alterations that are more closely related to innate immunity, this production of cells from the innate system, in contrast to classic homogeneous rheumatoid arthritis, which is associated with adaptive immunity. We also see that synovitis is much more common in patients with rheumatoid arthritis compared to tenosynovitis and extrasynovial involvement. And we also observe different responses mainly mediated by this clinical presentation of innate immune system versus adaptive immune system. Very well, the conclusions of this talk would be that most of the genetic markers used to identify patients with rheumatoid arthritis who are seronegative cannot be applied to patients with seronegative rheumatoid arthritis. We see that these differences in pathogenic pathways are also observed in the analysis of synovial fluid. we would say that from these changes in demographic and environmental risk factors, we are seeing an increased incidence of patients with seronegative rheumatoid arthritis. We have a better eye now and are diagnosing more. The classification criteria developed for seropositive rheumatoid arthritis may be different or may not classify patients with rheumatoid arthritis with seronegative rheumatoid arthritis. We could consider different diagnostic criteria. The exact method is effective for both, but its benefits are more convincing in patients with seropositive rheumatoid arthritis. The same goes for anti-TNF treatments, although we could consider this high switch rate of anti-TNF in seropositive rheumatoid arthritis. And it's true that these drugs, which target the adaptive immune system, have lower retention in patients with seropositive rheumatoid arthritis. Before finishing the talk, I asked myself this question at the beginning. And it's something that later on in our daily practice, we need to keep an eye on. What is it? We have patients with chronic seronegative polyarthritis who may not meet any specific criteria, but that doesn't mean we shouldn't treat them. We have a patient for whom we have a precise diagnosis in daily clinical practice, which is crucial, but even though these criteria exist and may not be adequate, if we delay treatment within what is known as this small so-called therapeutic window of opportunity, which is essential for achieving early remission of the disease and avoiding over-treatment, we could end up getting a bit lost. So, my question and comment, then, if you'd like to discuss it, Dr. Rosas, or anyone from the audience, is perhaps about this term we use, seronegative rheumatoid arthritis. It may no longer be appropriate, and we should consider a term that encompasses all these pathologies that can present initially as arthritis and that need to be treated before being classified. Very well, thank you very much.